The founding chair of the Communist Party of the Philippines, Joma Sison, has passed away. He was 83. The CPP says Sison had been confined for 2 weeks at a hospital in the Netherlands before passing away on Friday night. Calling Sison their teacher and guiding light, the party vows to carry the revolution forward. Joma, or Jose Maria Sison, founded the CPP in 1968 to protest against government policies and corruption during the presidency of Ferdinand Marcos Sr. He sought political asylum in the Netherlands in the late 80s after the Cory Aquino administration canceled his passport and renewed subversion charges against him. The conflict between the Philippine government and the communist rebels through its armed wing New People's Army has been ongoing for over 5 decades now. It's considered one of the longest armed insurgencies in the world. The group and Sison were designated as terrorists by the U.S. in 2002. Earlier this year, Sison expressed willingness to continue peace negotiations with the Philippine government under the Marcos Jr. administration. The talks were scrapped by former President Rodrigo Duterte back in 2019. Joining us this afternoon to talk more about the legacy of CPP founder that had left behind, Eduardo Araral, Associate Professor at the National University of Singapore. Good morning, sir.
Good morning, Nikki.
All right, thank you for joining us. Now, Sir Sison has been described as many things: a patriot, internationalist, revolutionary leader, and a great Marxist-Leninist-Maoist thinker. How did all this and these ideologies figure in his leadership of the CPP-NPA?
Right. His legacy, Nikki, really depends on who you ask. So the characterization of his colleagues at the Communist Party that he is a great Marxist-Leninist-Maoist thinker, it's probably correct. He has written quite a lot of books. In fact, he would qualify as a full professor at the university if he was a full professor. So he's indeed an ideologue and a guiding light and a teacher to the revolution. He was undoubtedly a patriot and an internationalist and a revolutionary leader. That's one perspective. But the other perspective is, if you ask the widows of the soldiers and the policemen who died fighting the New People's Army, that he's Joma Sison and his group is just a bunch of terrorists. And if you ask farmers who have been protected by the New People's Army, they probably would support him, would worship him. So his legacy really, Nikki, depends on who are you asking.
And Professor, let's take a look at history. Sison was among the political prisoners released by Cory Aquino in 1986 after the ousting of dictator Ferdinand Marcos Sr. And then he left Manila for a lecture tour of Asia and Europe. But then he was relentless against Aquino, prompting her government to cancel his passport while he was in the Netherlands. So what does this move about tell us about him and his principles? What are the highlights of his career through these administrations?
Right. Interestingly, Nikki, I was a student at UP Los Baños in 1987 when he visited my university, and I met him personally. And that was before he left to do his talks, and he never came back since 1987. But he pursued his war and his leadership of the Communist Party for 35 years in the Utrecht. So he was really determined to see his vision. And his vision for the Philippines really is to overthrow the government and the ruling elites and to install the Communist Party of the Philippines. And even as late as during Duterte's time, he wanted a power-sharing agreement. So he lasted for more than 50 years. So in that sense, he was really a committed revolutionary, a patriot at that, if that's how his colleagues describe him to be.
And Professor, let's also take a look at the Ramos presidency. While dangling peace to the CPP, then-President Fidel V. Ramos mounted this massive intelligence operation against the guerrillas in 1992, which exploited their internal squabbles and infiltrated their top units, leading to the arrests of nearly the entire leadership of the CPP, and what Ramos would describe then as the irreversible decline of the communist movement. What was Sison's role in this?
Well, you know, Sison, at that time, he was in jail at that time, right, 1980s. But he was the ideologue. he was quite influential still. He provided the guiding light to the movement, and that eventually resulted in the purgings or internal cleansing of the New People's Army and its CPP and the NDF that led to thousands of innocent deaths within the party. And Ramos was correct that it led to paranoia within the Communist Party that led to their eventual weakening. But they also had some resurgence during the time of Cory, and of course eventually weakened during the time of Ramos until most recently. Nikki.
Mm-hmm. Now, Professor, John Masison also played a key role in the insurgency split in the early 1990s, right, that turned the communist movement into several factions, a shadow of its old self, nga po. Can you tell us more about this? What are some of the most impactful moments of his leadership in the CPP-NPA?
Right. So, eventually, there was a split in the communist movement. The traditionalists led by Season, and then the other groups who didn't believe the tactics and the strategies of Season. The tactic of Season is it's an extended proletarian revolution, and you encircle the cities. It's a classic Maoist revolution. Mm-hmm. So they differed in terms of ideology, differed in terms of strategy, differed in terms of tactic. And whether there should be an armed component or there should be a legal component. But Joma persisted on having, insisting that there should be an armed component and coupled with a legal component, what he called the National Democratic Front. So throughout all this odyssey, if you will, Joma Sison played a key role, ideological role, in shaping the course of the communist movement. Okay.
Mm-hmm. And let's talk about more recent events. In 2019, former President Rodrigo Duterte terminated all peace negotiations with the communist rebels, right? And instead created a task force in a bid to quash the insurgency. But before leaving his office, Duterte said it is up to the next president whether the government will pursue another round of peace talks with the CPP. What do you see for the CPP and the Marcos government after Sison's death, considering his and the insurgency's history with his father's presidency?
Right. Now, so the armed component of CPP, the NPA, has now been weakened over time, not just because of government effort or by the military, but because they're having a lot of difficulty recruiting fresh blood and renewing their political commitment to their cause. It's no longer as popular as in the 1970s or the 1980s. So the effort of the government to push forward with this localized grassroots-based approach to win back the basis of the communists or the New People's Army, I think that's what the Marcos administration is trying to do, to bring basic services to this previously held territories, to win back the hearts and minds of the people who once joined the communist movement. The military has also said that they are not keen to have a Christmas ceasefire with the NPAs because they don't know who to talk to. There's no more leaders. They feel that the movement has been weakened with the death of Joma Sison. They feel that they now have the upper hand, and that the communist armed groups are now limited to a few areas in Bicol, maybe in Negros, and a few regions. They've become much, much weaker now compared to where they were in the 1980s. Okay.
Mm-hmm. And following all this, how much of what the word communist in the Philippine political climate is attributed to Joma Sison and his history? How has it changed through the years? How do you think this CPP-NPA will move forward with its operations then?
Well, Nikki, those who are old enough to have read his book, The Philippine Society and Revolution, and other books, Joma Sison played quite influential role in shaping the terms of the debate, in terms of shaping the terms of the ideological movement. But this ideology has become passé, Nikki, because if you've seen what happened to the rest of the world, Cuba is opening up, Vietnam is no longer a communist state, China is no longer a communist state, the Soviet Union has collapsed, and all other communist countries are no longer around. So Joma has stuck to his, that's a problem that, you know, he has not updated his ideology, that the world has moved on. And I think he lived a comfortable life in Utrecht, and he is out of touch with what's happening on the ground in the Philippines. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. On that note, thank you so much for joining us this morning on the show, Professor Araran. You stay safe, and thank you for your insights.
Thank you.